I'm Dr. Karen Hildebrand with AWS.
And I'm Travis Mellinger with Cisco, and this is My Architecture.
So Travis, Cisco is a large organization. Mm-hmm. You brought us an architecture. Can you tell us what this particular architecture solves for?
Yes, so we are talking about the large language model proxy, which is an application that runs here in our EKS cloud. And what the LLM proxy does is make it easier for developers working on the Webex portfolio of applications to integrate large language models into the experiences they're trying to build into the Webex portfolio.
So you've abstracted a bit of the complexity of using large language models. Can you tell us how you did that?
Sure. So it is a relatively simple service that runs here in the cloud that provides some useful abstractions and common patterns that developers working on Webex applications are accustomed to. So one example is identity, authentication, authorization. There is a common framework for that inside the Webex ecosystem, which the large language model proxy adheres to, like the rest of the applications. So developers, when they want to talk to it, they can talk to it in a secure way that looks just like all the other applications. And it also gives us a nice way to collect information about large language model providers. If we want to know, when somebody is making requests to Bedrock or to SageMaker or all the way out here to an external provider, we have teams that are trying all sorts of different providers and models. We have one place where we can capture information, operational information, and also some data where it's appropriate. We can do that in one place instead of developers all the way over here having to do that n number of times for each one of these providers or models they want to integrate.
So say I'm an end developer and I want to submit a request for Titan response.
Right.
How would that flow through?
Simple. You make a request to our team. We would like support for Titan. We already have support for Titan. That's already in there. But if they have a model that they would like to use, then we plug it in, if you will, to the large language model proxy. And then the only thing that they need to know to make a request from their service over here is what the shape of the request looks like. Obviously, Bedrock looks a little bit different from SageMaker, looks a little bit different from some other provider's API, but that's all they need to know. Instead of having to do, the full API integration, they simply need to know what the shape of the input looks like, and then they're on their way.
Terrific. And then as that is captured, can you tell me a little bit about how you think about that from a regulatory, future-proofing the design, and potentially a data lake structure?
Sure. So you mentioned our data lake, which is all of this bit down here, and it solves a number of problems. So the ones you mentioned, kind of future-looking regulatory sort of things, we have a responsibility and we have a responsible AI framework that helps us govern, how we think about this. But we have a responsibility to make sure that the platform, that the large language models that we're integrating, they're not being abused. So we need to prevent abuse. We need to prevent security issues. We need to prevent prompt injections, among many other issues that that could come up. We have a responsibility to make sure that we have solved those kind of problems. But then we also, we have these operational concerns where we want to understand how models are performing. We want to understand how much usage we have of a given model. So an application making a request to the LLM proxy, which then, say goes over here again to Bedrock, we know who made that request. We know how many requests they made. We're logging, we're recording metrics for all of this information so that we can then, use this over here to query it, which helps us with problems like cost optimization. If we want to know, if we have particularly high usage of one model, that might give us a good reason to go to provisioned pricing instead of on-demand pricing. All that operational information helps us make decisions like those.
And also probably helps with things like latency and understanding response times based on what model was selected, things like that?
Exactly, all of those sorts of things. Like all of that, we can gain those insights by the information we capture right here. But it's not just the operational information. We also, we want to be able to train better models. We want to be able to validate how well our models are behaving. But we also have a responsibility to our customers to ensure that we are using data in ways that they expect us to use, the way they have consented to use. Yep. Large language model proxy solves that problem for us very well. So where customers have indicated consent to us, whether they're, they're working with us in partnership on a new feature, or if they're participating in trials and consent to allow us to use data, whatever the reason may be, one of these applications over here in the ecosystem simply needs to indicate consent on the customer's behalf to the proxy, and then we can capture this information in one place. Whereas if we were solving the same problem over here in a Webex microservice. Depending on which provider they plugged in, like, they would have to do all of that over here. They would have to capture the information. They would have to store it in a secure way. Instead, we do it all in one spot.
That's fantastic. So you've basically done the undifferentiated heavy lifting for your application
yes,
developers.
I only learned that term recently, and I love it because that is exactly what we're doing.
Fantastic. Thanks for taking the time to share this architecture with us today, Travis. This is really exciting, and I think there will be a lot of customers who will benefit from hearing from this.
Of course. Thank you very much for having me.